Chapter 1 of The Fairy Latchkey. The Fairy Latchkey by Magdalene Horsfall. Chapter 1, which introduces the heroine and others. There was nothing at all remarkable about her, excepting her name, which was Philomene Isolde, and the fact that a knot of green ribbon had been sewn upon her christening dress. But the dress had long since lain folded in a drawer, and her father, as often as not, called her Little Miss Muffet, because she was so very fond of curds and whey, and very much afraid of spiders. When he did call her Philomene, it meant that he was too busy to have her in the room with him. Unlike most people, she was satisfied with her own name. Indeed, she was proud of it, for Daddy had told her that Philomene meant beloved, and as for Isolde, that was Godmother's own name. And Isolde, said Godmother, was a real princess. I wish I were a real princess, said Philomene, and waited for Nurse to add, if wishes were horses, miss, beggars might ride, which she forthwith did. Philomene was not a pretty child, but neither was she exactly plain, for she had small hands and feet and a trim little figure, hazel eyes and plenty of soft mouse-coloured hair, and if there was nothing unusual about her appearance, there was certainly nothing unusual about her home, for she lived in a commonplace suburb of London, in a commonplace villa called Sideview. The house undoubtedly had two sides, but scarcely any view, unless the strip of back garden counted as such. The drawing-room and dining-room opened out of a narrow hall, and both had about them the chill and mustiness of disuse. For since the death of Philomene's mother, the drawing-room had seen no more parties, and her father, who was a hard-working doctor, as often as not snatched his hurried meals in the study rather than in the dining-room. Philomene's own bedroom and schoolroom on the upper landing were large, airy rooms for the size of the house. At the foot of her bed stood a screen, upon which Froggy went a-wooning, and Little Red Riding Hood carried her covered basket through the wood, and on the wall opposite hung a picture of a young shepherdess clasping her crook and kneeling in the shade of a spreading oak tree. As there was no flock in sight, Philomene at first supposed her to be Bo Peep before her sheep came home, but Godmother had told her that it was Joan, the maid of Orleans, who died for love of France and of the truth, and from that time forward on winter evenings, when the salamanders began their torchlight reveals on the earth, Philomene would lie in bed and watch the ruddy reflection brighten and broaden among the branches of the oak, wrapping the frail young figure in a winding sheet of flame, and placing the hard-won wreath of martyrdom upon her hair. Over the mantelpiece in the schoolroom next door hung another picture, one which had belonged to Philomene's mother. There was a road white with dust in the foreground, disappearing amidst a clump of trees, above which floated a wreath of blue smoke. Down the road there sloped a bank of grass, and there sat a woman with a child in her lap, while a bird on the wing paused to peck from an ear of corn which the baby held in his hand. Beside the two, an old man with kind eyes and work-worn hands was unsaddling a small grey donkey, and a little further down the road stood a ruined shrine with a broken idol. Philomene liked the donkey with its long ears and sad eyes, but felt grateful to the old man for allowing it to nibble the grass at all. It was in the schoolroom that Philomene kept her toys. There was the doll's house and the doll's kitchen and the musical box and the paint box with its palettes and saucers and brushes. Last, but by no means least, came the bookshelf. It held all of Mrs. Ewing's stories and all of Mrs. Molworth's Grimm and Hans Andersen and many more besides. Philomene used to act all the stories out of these books, but it is dull work to be both players and audience yourself, and it needs an imagination bordering on genius to ride alone upon a bed and persuade your heart of hearts that it's a Pegasus, the wonderful winged horse. And nothing ever happens to me, mused Philomene, as it happens to people and books. I do not live in a chateau with a terrace and a raven like Jean in the tapestry room. And when I play with the reels in Nurse's workbox, they do not behave in the least like Louise's reels and tell me a story. I suppose it is because I am just ordinary. It was a depressing thought, but facts could not be shelled. Philomene's cuckoo clock certainly acted very different from Griselda's. So far from inviting her to climb up by the two long dangling chains and take a seat opposite to him on a red velvet armchair, this disobliging bird uttered its cuckoos in a hasty, perfunctory manner, and then shut to the door of his house with a snap, as who would say, "There's over till next time." In the schoolroom window hung a cage with a canary in it. It was of a bright yellow, all but his head, which was green, and Philomene had christened him Master Mustard Seed, after one of the fairy pages in A Midsummer Night's Dream. Now this canary had something of a history. To begin with, he had a predecessor, a canary that had been yellow all over, and so tame that he would perch on Philomene's needle when she sewed, or upon the book when she read. Then one day the old maidservant, Lillian Augusta, had left the schoolroom window open and the cage door ajar, and the canary flew out, never to return, and there was a lamentation at Sideview. But a few days later, a strange thing happened. Through the open window, into the empty cage, flew another canary, this time with a little head as green and velvety as moss. Master Mustard Seed, in short, who had remained with his new mistress ever since. Besides her canary, Philomene kept another pet, a white cat called Queen Mab, with paws as soft as pussy willow and a footfall as light as any snowflake. Now this was how Queen Mab had first come to Sideview. It was Christmas Eve, and Philomene stood at the dining-room window, listening to the waits who were singing a Christmas carol. "Here lies mid the beasts of the stall, who is maker and lord of us all. The winter wind blows cold and dreary. See, he weeps, the world is weary. Lord, have pity and mercy on me. Come, come, come to the manger. Kneel ye now to the newborn king. Sing, sing, chorus of angels. Stars of the morning, O Bethlehem, sing." After that, they moved on to the next house and began the second verse. "He leaves all his glory behind, to be mourned and to die for mankind. Midst grateful beasts his cradle chooses, thankless man his love refuses. Lord, have pity and mercy on me." It was bitterly cold. Philomene closed the window, and as she did so, a mew caught her attention. In another moment, she had the hall door open, and a gust of icy air met her, as though the very wind was trying to force its way into the house for shelter. Upon the doorstep sat a white kitten, draggled and shivering. Philomene picked it up at once, shut the door and ran upstairs to the schoolroom, all in a flutter of pity and excitement. Nurse looked up from her sewing and stared at her aghast. "Well, Miss Philomene," she exclaimed at length, "I wonder what you will be up to next. Put that dirty little cat down this minute." Philomene obeyed. "I wanted it to have some of the milk that was left over from supper," she protested timidly. "And so it may," retorted nurse, whose bark was worse than her bite, "so long as you don't go on holding it against your dress." So Philomene took a saucer and busied herself with the kitten on the hearth rug. This was a bearskin and had figured many a time in solitary games of Beauty and the Beast, for it had served as the hero's costume, till he finally became a prince and discarded it, when Philomene, whose housewifely little soul disliked waste, had made the princess suggest that it should be lined with red flannel and turned into a useful rug for the throne room. The kitten lapped up the milk eagerly and settled itself comfortably in front of the fire. "And now you had better put it back where it had come from, miss," said nurse. "The saucer?" inquired Philomene blankly. "No, child, the cat." "But it came from the doorstep," exclaimed Philomene, seeing no relenting in nurse's face. She burst into tears. At that moment, her father came into the room.
"What? Tears, little maid?" he called out in surprise.
"Oh, Daddy, it's so cold outside, and it hasn't done anybody any harm, and it won't have any Christmas. But perhaps it's one of the grateful beasts in the carol," sobbed Philomene.
"It certainly seemed grateful enough for the milk," said nurse, who had not listened to the waits and was of a literal turn of mind. "But I don't much fancy a stray cat in the kitchen all the same." The doctor sat down on the red cushioned rocking chair and took his child on his knee. He
who was a tall, well-made man, with dark hair, keen eyes, and a somewhat abrupt manner. But he was never anything but gentle with his little daughter, and Philomene's sobs subsided as he stroked her hair and patted her cheek. "Look here, little Miss Muffet," he said, "I will tell you what we will do. We will ask Nurse to let us keep the pussy overnight, and later on we will advertise in the newspaper, just as we did for Master Mustard Seed. And if it doesn't seem to belong anyone, or to come from anywhere in particular, you shall have it for your own. And Nurse won't mind if it catches the mice in the scullery, will she?" Philomene's face cleared, and she looked beseechingly at Nurse. "You are master of the house, sir," admitted Nurse, "and it seems useless to fight against this love of dumb things. Cats especially do seem to run in families." So the white kitten stayed and grew into a white cat, glossy and well-liking, that followed Philomene about the house. "Like a dog," said the people who had never taken the trouble to befriend a cat. End of chapter 1.
Chapter 2 of The Fairy Latchkey by Magdalene Horsfall. Chapter 2, which introduces the heroine's godmother.
If Philomene had not actually a fairy godmother, she had at least the nearest possible approach to one. To begin with, Godmother was beautiful. She had the red hair that artists love, a wild rose complexion, and a gentle, even voice which never scolded and never sneered. She had cool, white hands with twinkling rings, and her dresses made a stately silken frou-frou on the stairs, bringing with them a faint fragrance of lavender and old-world potpourri. She had a dear little country house called the Cushats, which stood among pine woods where pigeons cooed to each other all day long, and the sea was not far off. Here, the summer holidays were spent by Philomene. Little Cushat, as Godmother called her at times, for, as the Danish proverb says, a dear child has many names, she would sit by the hour in the oak-panelled drawing-room, strumming on the quaint old spinet, or in the window-seat reading, while the bees murmured perpetually in the blossoming lime-tree outside. The garden was full of what are usually called old-fashioned flowers, though for my own part I should be slow to connect anything quite so tiresome as fashion with anything quite so lovely as flowers. There the snowdrops came at Candlemas, and the daffodils on Lady Day, and there was a whole big hedge of the rosemary that Shakespeare loved. Besides the Cushats, Godmother had a house in London, where there were broad flights of stairs with shallow steps and vistas of reception rooms with polished floors and beautiful pictures and cabinets filled with Eastern curios. Grandmother's own boudoir was a remote, hushed corner where in midwinter forced lilac drugged the air with subtle sweetness. It was here that Philomene often took tea with her, and when full justice had been done to the toast and cakes, Isolde would take her seat in a low chair before the fire, and Philomene, curling herself up on the hearthrug, much as Queen Mab might have done had she been invited, would lay her clasped hands in her godmother's lap and begin to want to know. "Godmother," she said on one of these occasions, "I want to know if it's cruel to keep caged birds. Do you remember when you took me to church with you a few Sundays ago, and they went round singing the litany? Well, just as the choir men passed me, they were saying, 'And to show thy pity upon all prisoners and captives,' and I thought at once of Master Mustard Seed."
"But Master Mustard Seed came to you of his own accord," replied Godmother in her kind, low voice, "and I think a canary might find it very difficult to fend for himself if you set him free in England. All the same, when you are grown up, you need never keep any caged birds if you do not want to."
"Well, then you know the picture in the schoolroom with the baby in it, and the bird pecking at the ear of corn?" continued Philomene. "I had just made up such a nice story about it all when Miss Mills told me that it was a flight into Egypt, and I ought not to make a play of it. But how was I to know? They hadn't any halos. And, oh, Godmother, I had just planned that the ugly idol had enchanted a prince and princess and had turned them into a donkey and a bird, and that the grass and the corn they were eating would turn them back again. Then I asked Miss Mills what the idol and the bird really did mean, but she could not tell me. She only said she supposed it must be some silly legend. Whenever Miss Mills does not know the answer to what I ask her, she says it must be a silly legend. What do they mean, Godmother?
The picture is a modern one, said Isolde. That is why the Holy Family are painted without halos, and Miss Mills was quite right about it being a legend. Your mother once told me all the different things that the painter had tried to express in his picture. The smoke above the trees is supposed to come from an inn, where the innkeeper and his wife have just refused to give shelter to the travellers. And it is said that their children's children are the gypsies, who have now no settled home or shelter of their own. Then there is another story that when the idols of Egypt recognized a true god, they fell down and were heartbroken. The bird with the outspread wings is the human soul, and the Lord is feeding it with the bread of life.
Still, you don't think the Holy Family will mind my having made up the other story about them, do you? Inquired Philomene anxiously, but Godmother only shook her head and smiled.
Philomene certainly asked a great many questions, but then Isolde was never tired of answering them. Yet though she loved her goddaughter dearly, it was not entirely for her own sake, for she was Rachel's child. Rachel and Isolde had known each other almost all their lives. As little children, they strung daisy chains and made cowslip balls together. As schoolgirls, they helped each other with their compositions and Simon de Montfort and the pleasures of a country walk. And when they had grown to womanhood, Rachel's marriage in no way lessened their friendship. It was while she lay dying that she confided her baby to the love of her friend. Be good to her, beloved as you have been to me, and I should like her to be called Isolde Philomene, Isolde. A portrait of Rachel in her wedding dress hung in Isolde's boudoir, and Philomene had grown to love the sweet face and the white folds of the train. On entering the room, her first glance was always for Godmother, and the second for her mother's portrait.
End of chapter 2. Chapter 3 of The Fairy Latchkey by Magdalene Horsfall. Fairy Latchkey by Magdalene Horsfall, Chapter 3, which tells of a keyhole in a wall. When Miss Philomene was still quite a little girl, she had had some playfellows whom neither nurse nor Miss Mills knew anything about, and these were her green dwarfs and Miss Hardy. The green dwarfs, there were six of them, lived in the wall beside her bed. They wore pointed shoes and peaked hats, and they waited upon her as pages. She could not remember her having deliberately invented them. She had gradually come to know them. No sooner had nurse closed the bedroom door and sat down to her sewing machine at the schoolroom table, then Philomene would knock upon the wall against which her bed was placed, and the dwarves would appear. Not all together, but one by one, peaked hats foremost. Then they would keep her amused, generally by storytelling, till she felt herself growing drowsy. When she would wave her hand right royally, and back they would disappear into the wall. Mrs. Hardy was her companion in the daytime, and she was a most useful friend, equally good at inventing games and at helping with lessons. Moreover, strange to say, she always came to live at Sideview when Godmother was out of town, and as soon as Godmother returned, Mrs. Hardy would take a journey to Troy or the Rocky Mountains or some such place of interest, promising to revisit Sideview as soon as Godmother left London, and to be sure and give Philomene an exciting account of her adventures abroad. But as Philomene grew older, she gradually realized with sorrow that neither the green dwarfs nor Mrs. Hardy were anything more than a make-believe, and in her grief at having had to say goodbye to them, she turned for comfort to the pleasures of story-writing and to the thought of the mysterious keyhole in the garden wall. The garden of Sideview was flanked on three sides by a wall, and on the fourth by the back of the house.
there was a lawn bordered by a path, and at the end farthest from the house there was a large strawberry bed. Flower beds laid out between the path and the wall, some young fruit trees that never seemed to bear any fruit near the strawberry bed, and close to the house an iron staircase with a pump at the foot of it, clamped to the level of a garden door that opened out of the schoolroom.
I wish a fairy caretaker with a red cloak lived in our garden wall and would tell me stories as she did to Mrs. Molesworth's children, thought Philomene regretfully. But then that was in the enchanted garden, and I never did see a garden in all my life that looked less enchanted than ours. It is so flat, and there is no water in it unless you count the pump. No pond or fountain, and it isn't a bit neglected either, with the man coming twice a week to mow the grass.
One large flower bed, about halfway down the garden, was Philomene's very own. It was divided in two by a tiny path, on either side of which grew marigolds and London pride, and her initials in mustard and cress. The box-bordered path ended abruptly, where it ran against the wall, and it was in this wall that the unaccountable keyhole was to be seen. Philomene reasoned that where there was a keyhole, there must be a key, and a person to turn it. Yet she had watched it by the hour, as a cat watches a mouse hole, but without result. So that last, she gave up hope and went back to her story writing. It was an afternoon early in May. Tea was over, and Philomene sat in the red cushioned rocking chair, scribbling her latest novel. It was very quiet in the schoolroom, only the ticking of the cuckoo clock, the click of nurse's knitting needles, and the scratching of Philomene's pen were to be heard. They had just come to the castle, Philomene had just written. An old man who must have seen the snowdrops herald the spring some 90 times, with an aged woman to cook. She was not altogether pleased with the sound of this sentence when it was finished, but after making several vain attempts to alter it, she added a footnote. Bad grammar, but unavoidable. "Miss Philomene," said nurse, "I wish you would go out to the garden like a dear good child. Only look at the fine weather. And it isn't as if you were writing anything for Miss Mills, neither." So Philomene rose reluctantly after having first written "to be con" at the end of the page, for she had not as yet made up her mind whether the story was to be continued or concluded in our next. Then she fetched her garden hat and went to fill her watering can at the pump. It was still and sunny in the open, and the hum of insects sounded louder than the hum of traffic. In the lilac bush, a blackbird was practicing his grace notes so as to be in good voice for the many concerts of the oncoming season, and a warm west wind passed through the garden in long, happy sighs, as though the young summer were drawing its first deep breaths of lazy contentment. Philomene began watering and weeding her garden, and from time to time she looked up at the keyhole in the wall.
"If one is just ordinary oneself," she said half aloud, "and lives in an ordinary house, I expect fairy things simply can't happen. Some day, though, I must write a book about them, as if they really had happened. I suppose that is the next best thing."
At that moment, she caught sight of a dandelion about to seed, growing between her box borders. She stooped to pick the beautiful thing, and at once began to blow upon the nursery clock, so that the seeds took wing in all directions. End of chapter 3. Chapter 4 of The Fairy Latchkey by Magdalene Horsfall. Chapter 4, which introduces Sweet William.
"If you could let me have the right time, I should be obliged to you," said a voice at her elbow.
Philomene started, so that the now dishevelled globe of seeds fell from her hand to the gravel, and she turned to see who it was that had spoken to her. By her side stood a little man in a vivid green suit. In her first surprise, she thought it must be one of the six dwarfs come back to her again. But in another moment, she noticed that his shoes had rounded toes, and that his hat, although pointed, had a red and white cockade in it.
"That is not the proper way in which to treat a watch, child," said the mannequin crossly, and stooping to pick up the dandelion, he blew upon it gently. 5 o'clock, he said. "Just about tea time."
And then Philomene's heart gave a sudden throb, for out of his waistcoat pocket he pulled a key which fitted into the keyhole. A little stone door swung outwards in the wall, and the mannequin hesitated upon the threshold.
"All things considered," he remarked slowly, "and especially the green ribbons, I think I may do myself the pleasure of asking you to step in."
He was speaking quite politely this time, and Philomene entered, her pulse all aflutter, like some bird that has flown in by the window and cannot find its way out again. The door shut behind her, and she saw that she was in a little square room. The ceiling was of stone, as indeed was only to be expected, since it was part of the wall, but the floor was daintily, if unevenly, paved with shelves of different tints and sizes, while the walls were tapestried with catkins. In the middle of the room stood a monster mushroom serving as a table, with big toadstools to match on either side for chairs. The lighting was supplied by a will-o'-the-wisp, which hovered about near the ceiling till called for, when it would settle wherever it was needed. Philomene accepted the seat offered her on one of the toadstools, while the little man went to a hollow, moss-grown tree stump in the corner of the room and began to look for something inside it.
"You must excuse my going to the cupboard and waiting upon myself," he remarked. "I do keep a tomtit, but the weather was so fine that I thought it only fair to give him an afternoon out, so I must lay my own tea."
He placed one half of a walnut shell, a few clover blossoms, and a scrap of honeycomb on the mushroom table, and sat down on the other toadstool opposite his guest.
"If you have not already had your tea," he continued, "I can recommend this chew, which is one of the finest quality and kept cool by means of an icicle. I get my honey from an excellent farm, Buzz Bumble and Buzz Limited, and the clover was picked this morning. Plain fare, my dear, for this luxury-loving age, but thoroughly wholesome, I assure you. Have some?"
"I have had my tea already, thank you," said Philomene. "But I do like the sweet ends of the clover very much, if you could spare me one flower."
"Certainly, certainly," said the mannequin, and handed her two, one white and one pink.
"Would you mind telling me, please," began Philomene, "what you meant just now by speaking about green ribbons? Whose green ribbons?"
"Yours, of course," said the little man. "I shouldn't need any. If it hadn't been for those green ribbons on your christening robe, my young friend, you wouldn't be sitting here now. It is only the children that have worn green."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.